entirely sure, but we should be live. If you can hear me, please comment in the chat or something so I know that you guys all can see it and all that. But if not, then yeah, let me know. Yes. Anyway, thank you for joining me. It's White Paper Wednesday. This is the show where I read through a cypherpunk paper or a white paper or a BIP or something like that. It's to explain to you what's going on. Anyway, I just want to make sure that everyone can hear me. If not, please let me know. I will be switching to the desktop here. Yeah, if you can't hear me, please let me know. I guess I'm just going to assume that you can. All right, loud and clear. Great. All right, let's get going. But before I do, let me just tell you about a couple of my books. I got the Little Bitcoin book on paperback. It has 112 ratings on Amazon. It is available for $12 paperback, $9 Kindle, $6 audiobook. There's also the Programming Bitcoin, which is available from O'Reilly, $42.58. It's available in English, Korean, Polish. It is coming out in Chinese and Japanese and Russian at some point. If you are interested in translating this book, please contact me or, you know, just fork my GitHub and do it, I guess. It's more or less open source. All right. So anyway, today's is going to be a fun one. This is B Money from Wei Dai. This is actually, a paper that's referenced from the original Satoshi white paper, and I wanted to read it with you guys and tell you what it means. It's a very good paper. I think it's got a few subtle things that are very interesting, and you know, before like you'll see that proof of stake is in here and stuff like that. So let's take a look at it. All right, B Money by Wei Dai, November 1998. I'm fascinated by Tim May's crypto anarchy. Unlike the communities traditionally associated with the word anarchy, in a crypto anarchy, the government is not temporarily destroyed, but permanently forbidden and permanently unnecessary. So this is part of the cypherpunk manifesto or crypto anarchy. It's the idea that government is not just temporarily destroyed, it's a permanent unnecessary sort of appendage, so it kind of goes away. It's a community where the threat of violence is impotent because violence is impossible, and violence is impossible because its participants cannot be linked to their true names or physical locations. The idea being that at least on a digital basis, you can do these transactions without any knowledge by anybody. Of course, this isn't strictly true because we have physical locations, so there are always ways to be violated and so on. Until now, it's not clear, even theoretically, how such a community could operate. A community is defined by the cooperation of its participants, and efficient cooperation requires a medium of exchange, money, and a way to enforce contracts. Traditionally, these services have been provided by the government or government-sponsored institutions and only to legal entities. In this article, I describe a protocol by which these services can be provided to and by untraceable entities. So essentially, this is why we have AML KYC, right? Like, you need to know who the other counterparty is. There's no way to really enforce a contract or have recourse to sue without knowing who the other one is. And essentially what Wei Dai is going to describe is some sort of a protocol to mitigate both things. I will actually describe two protocols. The first one is impractical because it makes heavy use of a synchronous and unjammable anonymous broadcast channel. However, it will motivate the second, more practical protocol. In both cases, I will assume the existence of an untraceable network where senders and receivers are identified only by digital pseudonyms or public keys, and every message is signed by its sender and encrypted to its receiver. All right, so it's going to talk, he's going to describe the first one, and then the second one will sort of follow. By the way, guys, if you are enjoying this stuff, please pound that like button and click subscribe. All right. In the first protocol, every participant maintains a separate database of how much money belongs to each pseudonym. These accounts collectively define the ownership of money, and how these accounts are updated is the subject of this protocol. So essentially what he's describing here is a ledger, right? Like a ledger of what everyone has, what we call in Bitcoin the blockchain. Of course, it wasn't called that back then, because he's thinking, okay, well, who has how much and so on. One, the creation of money. Anyone can create money by broadcasting the solution to a previously unsolved computational problem. The only conditions that are that it must be easy to determine how much computing effort it took to solve the problem, and the solution must otherwise have no value, either practical or intellectual. So this is part of the whole idea of proof of work that that Satoshi figured out, is that it needs to be only useful for this thing. If it's useful for something else, then they might get reused. The number of monetary units created is equal to the cost of the computing effort in terms of a standard basket of commodities. Now, this is getting into sort of like IMF standard drawing rights or something like that. There is no standard basket of commodities. That's very easy to define, but that's what Wei Dai is proposing here. For example, if a problem takes 100 hours to solve on the computer that solves it most economically, and takes 3 standard baskets to purchase 100 hours of computing time on that computer on the open market, then upon the broadcast of the solution to that problem, everyone credits the broadcaster's account by 3 units. So this is sort of like the predecessor to proof of work. The idea is that you have to expend some amount of energy, and then once that comes into existence, then you can sort of trade it around. It's not very different than, say, rhinestones or gold or anything like that, and it's very much along those lines. The transfer of money. If Alice, owner of pseudonym KA, wishes to transfer X units of money to Bob, the owner of pseudonym KB, she broadcasts the message, "I give X units of money to KB," signed by KA. Upon the broadcast of this message, everyone debits Alice's account by X units and credits Bob's account by X units, unless this would create a negative balance in Alice's account, in which case the message is ignored. So this is the actual transaction, is Alice paying Bob some amount of money. The effect of contracts. A valid contract must include a maximum reparation in case of default for each participant party to it. It should also include a party who will perform arbitration should there be a dispute. All parties to a contract, including the arbitrator, must broadcast their signatures of it before it becomes effective. Upon the broadcast of the contract and all signatures, every participant debits the account of each party by the amount of his maximum reparation and credits a special account identified by a secure hash of the contract by the sum of the maximum reparations. What we're talking about here is some way of, it's what you would call a bond. It's money set aside in case something bad happens, and it has to be locked up. The contract becomes effective if the debits succeed for every party without producing a negative balance. Otherwise, the contract is ignored and the accounts are rolled back. A sample contract might look like this. Alice agrees to send Bob the solution to problem P before midnight on January 1st, 2000. Bob agrees to pay Alice 100 monetary units before January 1st, 2000. Charlie agrees to perform arbitration in case of dispute. Alice agrees to pay a maximum of 1,000 money units in case of default. Bob agrees to pay a maximum of 200 money units in case of default. Charlie agrees to pay a maximum of 500 money units in case of default. So this is a primitive smart contract, essentially. And essentially what we're saying is we have to have an arbitrator in the middle. Now, this is not trustless at all, because the arbitrator Charlie in this case can either cooperate with Alice or Bob and screw one or the other out of the money. But this is of course from 1998, so you could kind of understand what's going on, but you can see sort of like seeds of a lot of stuff that we know today. The conclusion of contracts. If a contract concludes without dispute, each party broadcasts a signed message. The contract with SHA-1 hash H concludes without reparations, or possibly the contract with Chawan-H concludes with the following reparations. Upon the broadcast of all signatures, every participant credits the account of each party by the amount of his maximum reparation, removes the contract account, then credits or debits the account of each party according to the reparation schedule, if there is one. So in other words, based on the contract, everyone updates the ledger. That's it. It's an execution of a smart contract. The enforcement of contracts. If the parties of a contract cannot agree on an appropriate conclusion, even with the help of the arbitrator, each party broadcasts a suggested reparation fine schedule and any arguments or evidence in his favor. Each participant makes a determination as to the actual reparations and or fines and modifies his account accordingly. So this is completely unworkable. Essentially what it's saying is every node should determine who was right in this case. Instead of having one judge, you have a million judges, or whoever is actually running a node, or the full ledger, in other words. In the second protocol, the accounts of who has how much money are kept by a subset of participants, called servers from now instead of everyone. These servers are linked to by a Usenet-style broadcast channel. The format of transaction messages broadcasted on this channel remain the same as in the first protocol, but the affected participants of each transaction should verify that the message has been received and successfully processed by a randomly selected subset of the server. So instead of everyone running a full node, it's now becoming like some subset of people that are running nodes. Since the servers must be trusted to a degree, some mechanism is needed to keep them honest. Each server is required to deposit a certain amount of money in a special account to be used as potential fines or rewards for proof of misconduct. Also, each server must periodically publish and commit to its current monetary money creation and money ownership databases. Each participant should verify that his own account balances are correct and that the sum of the account balances is not greater than the total amount of money created. This prevents the servers, even in total collusion, from permanently and costlessly expanding the money supply. New servers can also use the published databases to synchronize with existing servers. So, in other words, Wei Dai is promoting this idea that it shouldn't be everybody running or having access to the entire ledger, but that the server should commit to certain values and so on. This isn't that workable, and this is one of the reasons why Satoshi changed a lot of it. Unfortunately, this is the direction that Ethereum in this way is sort of a retrogression, right? Like it's going back, it's devolving instead of evolving. It's going backwards to more of this style. Also, this money in a special account for proof of misconduct, it's kind of like fees for like a masternode or something like that. The protocol proposed in this article allows untraceable pseudonymous entities to cooperate with each other more efficiently by providing them with a medium of exchange and a method of enforcing contracts. The protocol can probably be made more efficient and secure, but I hope this is a step toward making crypto anarchy a practical as well as theoretical possibility. And it certainly did, because did end up inspiring or at least giving some data to Satoshi Nakamoto, who in turn created Bitcoin. Appendix A, alternative B-money creation. One of the more problematic parts of the B-money protocol is money creation, and this is true. This part of the protocol requires that all of the account keepers decide and agree on the cost of particular computations. Unfortunately, because computing technology tends to advance rapidly and not always publicly, this information may be unavailable, inaccurate, or outdated, all of which would cause serious problems for the protocol. And this is what proof of work and difficulty adjustment really solves. See, Wei Dai identified right here that any sort of like metric, because computing power gets better and better, it's not really workable unless everyone agrees. But the brilliance of Satoshi was marrying proof of work to this and then adding a difficulty adjustment so that it automatically adjusts every 2 weeks. And that way you don't have to worry about the advancement in computing technology. So I propose an alternative money creation sub-protocol in which the account keepers, everyone in the first protocol or the servers in the second protocol, instead decide and agree on the amount of B-money to be created each period, with the cost of creating that money determined by an auction. Each money creation period is divided up into four phases as follows. One, planning. The account keepers compute and negotiate with each other to determine an optimal increase in the money supply for the next period. Whether or not the account keepers can reach a consensus, they each broadcast their money creation quota and any macroeconomic calculations done to support the figures. This is a little bit more Keynesian than Bitcoin. The idea being that they together determine the inflation schedule instead of having it fixed from the beginning. Bidding. Anyone who wants to create B money broadcasts a bid in the form of XY, where X is the amount of B money he wants to create and Y is the unsolved problem from a predetermined problem class. Each problem in this class should have a nominal cost, MIPS year say, which is publicly agreed on. Again, getting public agreement is half the battle, and this is kind of unworkable. Computation. After seeing the bids, the ones who place bids in the bidding phase may now solve the problems in their bids and broadcast the solutions. Four, money creation. Each account keeper accepts the highest bids among those who actually broadcast the solutions in terms of nominal cost per unit of B money created and credits the bidders' accounts accordingly. So that's, you know, this appendix is sort of like a very bad way to create money, as it requires a lot more coordination, and nobody's actually done that. Some of this other stuff, like proof of stake, other coins have tried, they don't really work. But, you know, there are lots of really good ideas in this paper, including the idea of using computing power to create money. Satoshi also extended that to actually securing the ledger instead of this messy sort of committing hashes to like a Usenet group or something like that. So a lot of the germs of the idea were here all the way at the beginning. All right. I think that I mean, it's kind of a short paper, but very interesting and amazing to think that this a lot of these ideas existed in 1998. A lot of the, you know, like unworkable ideas are sadly in Ethereum, which is not a surprise. They're sort of like a backward step to Bitcoin in many ways. So that's what it is. All right. Once again, my book, Little Bitcoin Book, is available on Amazon, available on paperback, Kindle, audiobook, Portuguese, and Spanish. Programming Bitcoin is available in Korean, English, and Polish. So if you are interested, please go and buy one. All right. Kind of a short show. Doesn't Decred technically work? Well, all right. So Decred is based on proof of stake to do governance, which I don't agree with. It's essentially representative democracy in many ways, and I mean, you can try it, but you're not really sovereign over your money. It's the representatives that are sovereign over the money, so that it's kind of not really it, and it's not decentralized. It's really just kind of like Congress or something like that. All right. Hope that helps you. Fiat Delenda.